This morning are from A Tree Grows in Brooklyn by Betty Smith. From that time on, the world was hers for the reading. She would never be lonely again, never miss the lack of intimate friends. Books became her friends, and there was one for every mood. There was poetry for quiet companionship. There was adventure when she tired of quiet hours. There would be love stories when she came into adolescence and when she wanted to feel a closeness to someone, she could read a biography. On that day, when she first knew she could read, she made a vow to read one book a day as long as she lived. She joined the founding faculty of Sangamon State University, now University of Illinois, Springfield, in 1970. Over her three-decade career, she became a professor of English and the dean of liberal arts and sciences, winning two awards for teaching excellence. She has served on the boards of the World Affairs Council, Lincoln Memorial Garden, Illinois Symphony Orchestra, and the Illinois Humanities Council. Since her retirement, she has offered seminars around the state and nation for the International Institute of Municipal Clerks and the University of Illinois Institute of Government and Public Affairs. We welcome you, Dr. Everson. Thank you for being here today.
Thank you so much for coming this morning. My name is Judy Everson, and it's always a pleasure to address the Unitarians because so many of you are current friends, former colleagues, and students. And I was particularly heartened by Delinda's conversation with the future readers of the congregation, given the focus of my talk today. You know, traditionally, on January 1st, we make a vow to improve our lives in the year ahead. And then, typically by February 1st, we abandon those good intentions. Our favorite pledges, to lose weight and to save money, both involve a trade-off, giving up instant satisfaction for deferred gratification. So we find it very easy to backslide. Whether you have already broken any of your 2016 resolutions, or perhaps proactively admitted defeat by not making any in the first place, I have come to try to help. Now, I regret to say that I cannot tell you how to win the Battle of the Bulge or the budget. If I could, I would have my own infomercial. What I can do instead is to offer an alternative resolution for your consideration, one that delivers gain without pain, one that gives you instant as well as permanent rewards. This morning, I want to invite you to make a recreational reading resolution by joining the 2016 Book of the Month Club. In an era of constant distraction from tweets and sound bites, the membership of this club, totally voluntary, concentrates on more complex and capacious narratives. Membership is open to any adventurous adult, and I see a lot of you in the audience, who are willing and able to read more and better books. There are no meetings or dues involved in this club, only each person's individual promise to sample 12 worthwhile full-length books, one for every month of the year. And you'll be glad to hear that compliance is based totally on the honor system. I considered Penny Wallenkrill's request that I come to you today truly providential, since I believe there is no better time than now to cultivate the habit of regular recreational reading. Winter's long spells of indoor confinement and occasional snowbound blizzards are perfect for pursuing this quiet, contemplative pastime. Choosing your own monthly selections would probably be the ideal option, especially if you are currently overstocked with books that you have been meaning to get around to for a while. However, if you have never done much exploratory browsing in bookstores or libraries, or if your selections lately have gotten into kind of a rut, perhaps you would welcome some assistance with getting started and staying on track in your New Year's resolution. I'm the lady who can help you because I've been a ravenous reader for the past 70 years. Like many of these children, I started out early, and I did it the way we vote in Illinois, early and often. I have brought some suggestions to share, and if you got a copy of the program today, you have a copy of my one-page suggested reading list. If you didn't get one, there will be one at the door when we exit. My recommendations, as you'll see as we go through them briefly together, are eclectic. They comprise both contemporary and classic works of fiction and nonfiction. Now, I realize, as a former English teacher, that tastes differ, and not all of you will necessarily like all of the books that I'm going to be recommending today. But what I can tell you is, to make my list, they had to satisfy three criteria. First of all, I had to have read them, and I had to feel that they were worth your attention. Secondly, other readers that I respect, both amateur and professional, had to vouch for their merits. And third, they had to be available in multiple formats. Taken together, I think that the books on this list show how reading broadly as well as deeply can alter our awareness, enhance our understanding, and change us for the better. And I want to amplify on that point by briefly previewing each of the featured titles so that you personally on your list can maybe put a thumbs up on the ones that you'd like to try, a thumbs down on the ones that don't appeal to you, and perhaps leave the others blank for future consideration. So, let the calendar countdown for 2016 commence. January is the month when we normally ring it in with the peal of church bells. I am inviting you to ring out the month of January with peals of laughter if you treat yourself next week to Jonas Jonasson's hilarious novel, The 100-Year-Old Man Who Climbed Out the Window and Disappeared. Hey, the title is so long, you're already halfway through the book. You will be charmed and, in fact, convulsed by Swedish centenarian Alan Carlson's merry misadventures after he flees his nursing home's 100th birthday party for him and hits the road. A former explosives expert, Alan is pleasantly offbeat, as are the random strangers who befriend him along the way, including, and I am not making this up, a beguiling elephant named Sonia. His wry recollections of chance run-ins with historical figures like LBJ and Mao Zedong will remind you of Forrest Gump, only funnier. Laughter, I think, is still the best medicine for what ails us, and this delightful dose of comedy will cure your winter doldrums. Now, in February, we in Springfield celebrate Lincoln's birthday as heartily as Valentine's Day, and so I came up with a proposed reading that links Lincoln and love, albeit in a kind of roundabout way. William Maxwell's slender story, So Long, See You Tomorrow, takes place in nearby Lincoln, Illinois, and depicts a tragic love triangle based on an actual case of adultery, murder, and suicide from that town's history. Maxwell, who was a native of Lincoln, Illinois, happened to be a classmate and friend of the killer's young son. And he was haunted by that incident and his inadequate, though understandable, response to it long after he left Lincoln and became the legendary fiction editor of the New Yorker magazine. This novel, with its autobiographical narrator, relates the heartbreaking, tragic chain of events without sensationalism on one hand or sentimentality on the other. And the result is a Midwestern masterpiece that punches far above its modest weight. Now, by March, outdoor enthusiasts among us are taking advantage of the defrost here in the heartland to resume our outdoor rambles. When you explore your surroundings on foot, do you ever wish for expert guidance on how to navigate the environment more alertly? If so, I recommend Tristan Gooley's practical handbook, The Lost Art of Reading Nature's Signs. It will sharpen your senses as well as stimulate your interpretive skills. He is a world traveler who is based in rural England, and he explains on every page how everyday phenomena that we often overlook, like cloud formation, tree placement, and wildlife distribution, reveal important larger patterns, like habitat patterns and also landscape. I highly recommend this book, whether you are an occasional stroller or a seasoned hiker. because it will speak to you wherever you are in your on-foot journey with equal ease. T.S. Eliot, the English poet who was born in St. Louis, famously said that April is the cruelest month. And I want to give you fair warning, this April will be very cruel to a subset of readers who are foes of William Shakespeare, because he died 400 years ago, this coming April 23rd. Now, if you, like many of us, were prematurely force-fed some of the bard's tragedies while you were in junior high or high school, perhaps you have been successfully avoiding him ever since. I am telling you now that will be impossible in 2016, so I urge you instead to embrace the anniversary by catching a performance or two of the Bard's immortal plays, because there are going to be many productions all the way from the local to the international level. Now that you are a grown-up, if you haven't re-experienced him, I think you will be amazed at just how powerful and pertinent he remains four centuries on. And if you are already a Shakespeare fan, then I invite you to experience his genius freshly by perusing Tina Packer's timely tome, Women of Will. She is an accomplished actor and director who draws on her vast theatrical background in the UK and the US to analyze his female characters from a feminist perspective. I think that her passion for the plays and her insight into their heroines will add to anyone's appreciation of Shakespeare on the page or the stage. While we're talking classics, let's turn to May's selection. When I was Dean of Liberal Arts at the campus just down the road, I frequently faced skepticism, both on campus and off campus, about the relevance of having students continue to take classes in history, literature, philosophy. I wish I had had at the ready the persuasive reply in Brian Dory's recent book, The Theater of War, What Ancient Greek Tragedies Can Teach Us Today. Dory's presents these venerable plays by Aeschylus, Sophocles, and Euripides in his own translations. He was a classics major at Kenyon. To service members, both active and retired, and their families, in locations as far-flung as Cuba and Kuwait. These interactive sessions that he conducts are designed to promote healing discussion of war's invisible as well as all too visible wounds. The discussions also demonstrate anew that myths, like the classical Greek myths, endure precisely because they express something so profoundly, so universally human, thereby fostering our resilience and our empathy when we are inevitably confronted by pain and loss. At mid-year, weddings and graduations and vacations compete for our attention. So I wanted to select readings for June that would be especially spellbinding from first to last. Hilary Mantel's acclaimed historical fictions on Thomas Cromwell, Henry VIII's advisor during the Anne Boleyn crisis, have gripped millions of readers on both sides of the Atlantic. If you have only so far seen the PBS TV adaptations of her books Wolf Hall and Bring Up the Bodies, I urge you to read the novels and find out once again why books are better. Just when you thought there was nothing new that could be said about the raucous reign of Henry VIII, Hilary Mantel cleverly cast Thomas Cromwell as her unlikely, unexpected, unconventional hero. 5 years of rigorous research underlies her sympathetic and revisionist portrait of this formidable force behind the English throne during the Protestant Reformation, which, by the way, made a major impetus toward making readers of us all. I strongly urge you to read her books now, because then you will be primed for the long-awaited climax of her trilogy, due out later this year. You know, Cromwell is not alone in being lately plucked from the shadows of history and thrust into the spotlight. Do you remember the saying, "Behind every successful man, there stands a woman"? July's book pays belated tribute to the long-suffering and long-overlooked wife of Winston Churchill. Would you believe that until Sonia Purnell's recent biography, there had never been a serious, full-length, professional study of Clementine Churchill's considerable contribution to her husband's consequential and controversial career, despite the fact that they were man and wife for 57 of the most exciting years of the last century? Her steadfast support, her shrewd counsel, her stabilizing influence helped to enable him to survive private tribulations, not to mention public turbulence in the times in which he had to govern. Now, thanks to Purnell, their political, as opposed to their merely marital partnership, is no longer the best-kept secret in recent British history. With August, of course, comes the start of the school year and a chance for you to have an intergenerational dialogue with a student in your life. Last year, I enjoyed just such a lively exchange with my granddaughter Bethany, who is now a freshman at Rochester. She was studying J.D. Salinger's novel, Catcher in the Rye, and it took me back to my own introduction to that novel in the 1950s when I was a teenager and not the grandmother of one. I wondered how it would hold up if I read it again along with Bethany. And I have to tell you that for me, Salinger's treatment of adolescent angst lost none of its poignance. But I also have to admit, off the record, that with the passage of years, my complete identification with troubled teen Holden Caulfield had abated a bit. This served as a healthy reminder that the act of reading is never the same as the act of rereading. And I invite you to discover or rediscover that truth for yourself by revisiting an old favorite from your bookshelves of long ago with a young person in your life. The ensuing conversation with your earlier self will probably be as revealing as the one you have with your youthful companion. In keeping with that back-to-school theme, September's selection also takes a retrospective stance. Daniel Klein's "Every Time I Find the Meaning of Life, They Change It" is as warm and witty and wise as its title. When he was a Harvard undergraduate philosophy major, he began keeping a notebook filled with quotations from sages through the ages on how to live a good life. Well, now he's retired and in his 80s, and he ran across this long-abandoned undergraduate notebook, and it set him to ruminating about what life had taught him in the meantime. His crisp, candid commentary on how his value system has changed with all those decades had me, and I think will have you, pondering the development of your own bedrock beliefs. If the unexamined life is still not worth living, he provides a model of purposeful self-scrutiny that avoids taking itself too seriously. Sooner or later, if we live long enough, and many of you, I can tell, have done that, got the gray hairs too and the wrinkles. Life has a way of sending us lemons and inviting us to learn how to make lemonade. The debut novel of October's author, Rachel Joyce, teaches us this truth in two ways. On one level, it tells the touching tale of an ordinary man's extraordinary struggle to save his soul while there is still time. But on another level, the biographical level, it reveals Rachel Joyce's own race to finish the book for her terminally ill father, whose courage in the face of the adversity of his disease had inspired her fictional protagonist's quest. The unlikely pilgrimage of Harold Fry launches the title character's journey with a blast from the past. Sedentary, retiree Harold Fry is literally jolted from his painful lethargy by a telegram from a long-lost co-worker and friend who is now in hospice. He decides on a whim to walk the 600 miles from his home in the far south of England to her bedside in the far north in order to atone for having failed her long ago at the time of their parting. On his arduous trek, he slowly recovers his self-respect and resolves persistent problems that have plagued him and his family. You will cheer Harold's dogged determination and applaud the brave new future he charts for himself with every faltering forward step toward his destination. In November, of course, I don't need to tell you that America will elect its next president. Thank God it will be over in November. And that will initiate the formal transfer of power at the pinnacle of our democracy. But behind the scenes, a more discreet transition will be taking place when the outgoing chief executive, Barack Obama, will be joining other living ex-presidents in an elite circle with a common but little-known cause to give off-the-record assistance to the current occupant of the Oval Office at any time of the day or night, because they alone know the challenges that that new person will face. This ultimate so far old boys network was founded without fanfare at Eisenhower's inauguration by his predecessors, Hoover and Truman. Putting aside their personal egos and their past partisanship, the members seek as unselfishly as possible to advance the national interest. Even cynics, I think, will relish the reporting of Nancy Gibbs and Michael Duffy, who uncovered the heretofore unknown activities of what they call the President's Club. Now, how better to round out your calendar year of 2016 than with a bountiful book about more books? If you accept my offer of a free trial membership in the 2016 Book of a Month Club by this next December, I hope that you will not only be ready to renew your resolution for 2016, which you don't need me to do, but that you'll also be on the lookout for more volumes that inspire and inform, entertain, and engage. For a plethora of possibilities, I leave you in the capable company of two Connecticut booksellers. They are Joy Johannesson and Roxanne Cody. And their essay collection, titled The Book That Changed My Life, gathers the opinions of 71 famous authors who have signed books in their bookstore. Here, I think you will find ample food for thought about future reading choices for 2017 and beyond. In conclusion, I'm sure that I am not the first, and maybe not even the last, to wish you a happy new year. But I may be the first to be bold enough to say that I can promise you a happy new year. If you maintain your membership in good standing in the Book of the Month Club, I think 2016 will prove to be more stimulating and satisfying than you might imagine. And so I wish you belatedly a happy new year, but right on time, happy reading. Thank you.
The closing words this morning are by Carl Sagan from Cosmos. What an astonishing thing a book is. It's a flat object made from a tree with flexible parts on which are imprinted lots of funny dark squiggles. But one glance at it and you're inside the mind of another person, maybe somebody dead for thousands of years. Across the millennia, an author is speaking clearly and silently inside your head, directly to you. Writing is perhaps the greatest human invention, binding together people who never knew each other, citizens of distant epochs. Books break the shackles of time. A book is proof that humans are capable of working magic.
Thank you.